Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee in 2022. Today we have apologies from the convener, Edward Mountain. Agenda item one this morning is consideration of a draft statutory instrument, the Public Water Supply Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. I welcome Mary McCallan, Minister for Environment and Land Reform, attending on behalf of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport. I also welcome the officials joining us today, Rosemary Greenhill, Regulatory Team Leader, Luigi Prodreschi, Solicitor, and Claire Phelan, Policy Officer. Thank you for attending. The instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following the evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that the officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. I'm very pleased to be here today and to move the Public Water Supply Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. Now, Scotland's drinking water is renowned for its excellent quality all over the world. We tend to take this for granted, actually, and very few of us appreciate how much effort is needed to treat the water in the first instance and then to monitor its quality to make sure that it's safe to drink at the tap. And safe in this instance, of course, meaning that it is free from substances that constitute a potential danger to human health. Now, in the interests of public health, we will continue to be relentless in ensuring that drinking water continues to meet the highest standards, and the draft regulations before the committee seek to do that. The main purpose of the regulations is to amend the Public Water Supplies Scotland Regulations of 2014 to implement health-based standards of the EU's recast Drinking Water Directive for drinking water supplied by Scottish Water. And these standards are recommended by the World Health Organisation. The EU's recast Drinking Water Directive, it came into force on the 12th of January 21. It is a long and complicated directive which is designed to protect drinking water from source to tap, to put in monitoring arrangements for emerging pollutants, to drive up efficiencies and to address access to water. We're taking a phased and phased approach and a proportionate approach to alignment with this directive because some of its requirements will rely on action still to be taken by the European Commission or will not apply until a later date. It's a vast directive and there are different timescales and there are different actions required by the EU Commission before all of the provisions could be brought in. But bearing this in mind and after considerable work, particularly on behalf of the officials here, we are moving forward with those health-based standards. So today's regulations, they update the standards that will apply to water supplied by Scottish Water. This includes new chemical parameters for substances commonly known as PFAS or forever chemicals and endocrine disruptors. Now, PFAS, we will know they're extensively used in products that have non-stick and water-repellent qualities. So, for example, in waterproof jackets, in cardboard that contains food, in SPF creams, they're found there. The regulations will require Scottish Water to check for the presence of these chemicals in drinking water that it supplies to make sure that it does not contain them at a concentration that would breach the limits specified in the regs. And of course, this is in line with the WHO. There are some additional changes made by the regulations, such as we're updating the values of existing substances that Scottish Water needs to monitor drinking water for, and the methods that they'll use to assess the microbiological, the chemical, and the indicator parameters. They also will enable Scottish Water, with the agreement of the Drinking Water Quality Regulator for Scotland, to deviate from minimum sampling frequencies for drinking water. We could deviate before, but this makes the requirements to do so more proportionate and therefore, we hope, more efficient. And they also introduced the requirement that Scottish Water maintain an operational monitoring programme. Again, there was monitoring before, but this is about enhancing that. So I mentioned that the directive is long and it's complex, but we're taking action now to implement these WHO recommendations that we can, and we're the first in the UK to do so. We're also taking the opportunity to make some minor changes out with the recast directive. For example, today's regulations update the frequency of sampling in relation to water supplied by tanker, and this is in response to an increasing use of mobile tankers by Scottish Water. And we implemented that following consultation with them. And the committee will also wish to note that the 1st of January 2023 has been selected as the coming into force date. And this has been selected because the annual monitoring programme of Scottish Water begins on the 1st of January. And this will allow a full monitoring record for 2023. And again, we've decided on that date following consultation with Scottish Water. So just to conclude, Deputy Convener, the approach being taken to align with the EU's recast Drinking Water Directive, we believe, is in the best interests of Scotland, ensures that the excellent standards of Scottish drinking water that we have become accustomed to are maintained, and we've done that by prioritising the health-based WHO-recommended improvements from the directive that can be made now. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. We now move to questions. I have a few questions, and I'll move to Mark Ruscoe and then to Liam Kerr. We've had Scottish Water in giving evidence in relation to their annual report, and there may be cost involved in this SSI. So would you explain the costs and how Scottish Water will be able to manage that within their existing or proposed budget?
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Convener. So we have estimated £10 million as being the upper limit of the cost of what we're seeking to implement today. That's, so we estimate it to be less than £10 million. And these costs, they arise generally in relation to the storage of chemicals at water treatment works, so that the standard in relation to chlorate and chlorine, chlorite can be achieved. There will also be some additional sampling costs. But we think that, all being taken into account, and obviously a very stretched position as regards public finances taken into account, this £10 million is money well spent when it is so directly linked to the maintenance of the highest quality of drinking water that we've become accustomed to in Scotland.
And can I ask what other countries are doing in relation to this recast directive, both in the UK but also in relation to other countries in the EU?
We're certainly the first UK country to to move to adopt these. I expect that other nations in the UK are considering how they do it. I can't speak for the pace at which they're doing it. We certainly hope they will, because, you know, as we were just discussing before we came to committee, water is not something that respects boundaries, and we all share an environment and we all want the highest standards. Having said that, I mentioned that this is a long, complex directive with some requirements that don't come into place until the late 2020s. So we do know that member states and non-member states like us have had to take quite a considerable amount of time to consider it and to plan for its implementation. And I expect member states are grappling with that just now, but certainly positive and worthy of pursuing.
And are there any implications for this SSI in relation to the retained EU law bill?
Yes, there are, and I'll certainly give my policy view, then I might hand over to Luigi for the legal perspective. But these regulations and the regulations from 2014 that they amend, that would constitute retained EU law. And therefore, whilst the government's policy position on this, I think, has been made clear by my colleague Angus Robertson, we want the bill revoked, or at the very least devolved aspects carved out of it. But where we are now, this would constitute EU retained law, and without actions to preserve it, the UK's bill as proposed would fundamentally undermine it. Luigi, I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that.
I don't think there is anything to add to it. I think you've explained it.
OK, thank you very much. I'll move to Mark Ruscoe and then to Liam Kerr.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think very welcome to see this ongoing alignment with EU law. But one of the points that was raised in the Constitution, External Affairs and Europe Committee was just around stakeholder engagement. Obviously, stakeholder engagement in Europe is extremely detailed throughout the policy development process and the development of regulations. Now we're sort of out of that. How have we attempted to replicate that stakeholder engagement at an appropriate level with the adoption of these regulations, and indeed thinking ahead as to what else might come forward through the directive over time that you may wish to align to, Minister, how you involving stakeholders in that, because we've kind of lost that architecture of really in-depth stakeholder engagement.
Yeah, no, you're quite right, and we would certainly, you know, that's one of the things we wouldn't want to ever see a diminution in as a result of having left the EU. So we would be keen to retain that consultation, and we've sought to do that in this. Now, these changes don't actually have an operational impact on Scottish Water, rather than the public who will turn on the tap, and you know, water will flow, and they will look to us and to Scottish Water to make sure that it's of the highest standard possible. So the consultation that we've done has focused mainly on consultation with Scottish Water, with the drinking water quality regulator. We shared a draft version of the regulations with them, and they were able to point us to some suggested improvements, particularly as regards that coming into force date. That was to align with Scottish Water's reporting period. We also have undertaken a series of, I think we would call them, project workshops with a suite of stakeholders on the question of alignment, the directive itself, and how we best align with it. And that involved, again, Scottish Water, the Drinking Water Regulator, WISC, SEPA, and I don't think I'm forgetting anyone, but that was certainly quite an involved process as well. But if I can compare that to something that might come down the road from the directive, work on private water supplies, that's a much larger piece of work with a much greater impact on the public, and therefore I'll be looking to undertake consultation again, but in a slightly different way that's more about public consultation, because it impacts them a great deal more.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else?
Mm-hmm. Nope.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. On that proposed cost of up to £10 million that was referred to earlier, can you give the committee any idea of what will be the impact of that coming out of Scottish Water's capital budget on any other capital projects that they have in the pipeline, or is there a move ultimately to increase their budget to accommodate that extra up to £10 million?
My view on it just now is that, and as part of the discussions and that consultation that I mentioned to Mark Ruskell that we've been having with Scottish Water, is that this is affordable within current budgets.
And you said that this would come in on the 1st of January 2023. How quickly does Scottish Water need to carry out this remedial work to accommodate this? Does that have to be done by the 1st of January 2023? Because if so, that's a very short lead time. And does that mean incurring the up to £10 million cost before the 1st of January 2023?
I might have to come back to you on exactly when the costs are incurred. I said they were about storage, so I can certainly update you on when exactly that will be incurred. But I might hand over to Rosemary, if you don't mind, just given some of those conversations that you've had with Scottish Water about the work that has to go into implement this on their part.
Yes, thank you. The standards come into effect on the 1st of January, and Scottish Water will be expected to meet those. They've had a lot of warning of this coming through. The directive was in its draft form in 2018. So we've seen this coming along, so they've had time to prepare. Those particular standards that the Minister mentioned about chlorite and chloride, about storage, so they've been able to address that very quickly. £10 million is the upper limit. Yeah. It's likely to be much less than that. Yes, they'll be expected to meet it.
May I just ask then, if it's been in draft for a long time and Scottish Water have had time to prepare, one would assume then that the question has been asked of them, are you going to be able to accommodate this by the 1st of January? Has that question been asked, to the best of your knowledge?
This is a public health measure about protecting public health, and it's in the interest of people that it's carried out, and Scottish Water has always recognised that public health is a major driver, and that drinking water must meet those standards.
Yeah, and just to come back to that point, the fact that it was Scottish Water that suggested to us that the 1st of January is the best date at which to begin, and that we've consulted with them throughout, they haven't flagged to us any issues with implementation. Indeed, it's been a collaborative getting to this point.
That's reassuring. And no further questions, Convener.
Anybody else? Oh, Okay. Well, we'll now move on to agenda item 2, and it's the formal consideration of motion S6M06537, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft Public Water Supply Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. I invite the Minister to speak to and move this motion in the name of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Convener. Moved, and I hope the committee will support.
I can now invite contributions from members. Any member want to make a contribution? No. Okay, so thank you. Minister, do you wish to say anything else? Are you happy to move on?
Thank you.
The question is that motion S6M06537 in the name of Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport, be approved. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much, and the committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to the convener to approve a draft report of the for publication. So thank you very much, Minister. Thank you. We can now move on to agenda item 3. Our next item is consideration of two negative instruments. We will first consider the Greenhouse Gas Emission Trading Scheme Amendment No. 2, Order 2022. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Mark?
Thanks, Convener. It's more a clarification, really. I was interested in the provision that allows effectively a free allocation under the ETS if heat is then going to another source. So instead of heat being wasted, it's then taken out of the industrial process and used somewhere else. I was just curious as to whether there were particular standards for that. Does this heat have to go to housing or other industrial processes, if there was any criteria around that? But no other comments actually on the SI beyond a clarification that it would be useful to receive in some form.
Any other points from Dean? I suggest that might be something that we can take offline and ask Spice to give us an update on. I don't think it necessarily affects the substance of the instrument and the procedures that are in front of us. If there are no comments and there's no motion to annul, I will invite the committee we've made our consideration of this. So thank you for that. So, is there anything else we need to do on that one? So I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to the instrument. Are we agreed? Agreed. Thank you for that. I will now consider the Producer Responsibility Obligations Packaging Waste Amendment Scotland Regulations 2022. The instrument is also laid under the negative procedure and no motions to annul have been made. Are there any comments on this particular motion or amendment? No, so again, I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendation in relation to this instrument. Are we agreed? Thank you all, and I now close the meeting. Thank you.